Good morning, students. Good morning to all. And last day we have studied about the small scale industries and large scale industries, and what is the role of small scale industries in economic development. So today just we will go to the next concept. So today just we will study about the nationalization of banks. Nationalization of banks. Why the government have to nationalize the banks? Mean, so after independence, the government of India adopted planned economic development. So for this purpose, 5-year plans came into existence since 1951. And not only that, the main objective of the economic planning aimed at social welfare only, as we have studied already. So before independence, commercial banks were in the private sectors. So these commercial banks failed in helping the government to achieve the social objectives of planning. So even if our governments are made the planning to achieve the economic goals, they need more amount, more financial facilities. But before the independence, all the banks are in the hands of the private sectors, and not only that, the private sector banks did not help to the governments to achieving their economic goals. So that the government decided to nationalize the 14 major commercial banks on 19 July 1969. So what are the objectives of nationalization of banks? Mean, the main objective of nationalization of banks was to attain social welfare, because all the governments, the state or the central government, also want to providing their social welfare to their peoples. So some of the sectors such as the agricultural, small scale and village industries were in need of funds for their expansion. So if it is like that, if the private sector banks are not given the help to attain the social welfare to the government, mean it will never providing the social welfare to the public. So the government decided to nationalize all the banks. Next, the nationalization of banks helped to curb the private monopolies in order to ensure a smooth supply of credit to the socially desirable sections. So whenever we want to providing the many financial facilities, so the private sector banks will never help. So that the government taken all the commercial banks, and after that it was helped to curb the private monopolies. Next, in India, nearly 70% of the populations lived in rural areas. So therefore, it was needed to encourage the banking habit among the rural populations. As the private sector banks will never establish any of the banking in the rural areas, but the 70% of the people who are living in these rural areas, if in this rural side, if there is no banks, the people will not have the habit of savings. But after nationalizing the banks, the government established many of the commercial banks even in the rural side, and the government helped to improve the habit of banking in the rural people. Next, the nationalization of banks were required to reduce the regional imbalance where the banking facilities were not available. If there is not available of the banks in the rural areas or in some of the particular areas, the regional imbalance will be increased. Wherever the banks are available, the people can have the more banking habits, so the saving habits, and because of that they will get some of the interest rate, and their capital formations also will be increased. But in the same time, wherever the banks are not available, these peoples will never get this type of the possibilities. So the government, after nationalizing the banks, the government established many of the banks without any of the disparities.
So next, the before independence, the number of banks were certainly inadequate. So after nationalizations, the new branches were opened in both rural and urban areas. So normally, if the banks are in the hands in the private sector, the private sector bank will never establish any of the banks in some of the areas wherever they are not able to having the profit. Next, the banks created credit facilities mainly to the agricultural sectors and its allied activities after nationalizations. So mostly the rural peoples or the agriculture peoples only will be in the need of financial facilities for their improving the agricultural sector. But the private sector's banks will never give the credit facilities to the farmers. So after nationalizing the banks, the government can give the more facilities, financial facilities to the farmers to improve their agricultural facilities. Next, 5-year plan. So already we have studied the 5-year plan. So normally if you want to doing something, before that we have to plan perfectly. If you have perfect plan, it is equal to completed 50%. So like that, the government also having this thought in their mind, it has decided to implementing the 5-year plans. The economic planning is the process in which the limited natural resources are used skillfully so as to achieve the desired goals. If the government want to achieve their desired goals, it must be having some of the perfect planning to achieving the goals. So the government has decided to implementing the 5-year plans. So till our nations are implemented the 12 5-year plans. The 12th 5-year plan only is considered as a last 5-year plan. And now the planning commissions also is not available. Instead of the planning commissions, the Nidhi Aayog is existing in our nations. So if you want to elaborately study about the 5-year plans, under the every 5-year plans, some of the achieved was decided. If you are taking the first 5-year plan, the first 5-year plan was implemented in 1951 to 1956. So the main objectives of the first 5-year plan was on the agricultural development of the country. Because after first war and after second war, the peoples in our nations were not self-sufficient in the food grains. So first, as a basic necessity of life, the food is the important one. So the government decided to focus on the improving in the agriculture. This plan was successful and achieved the gross domestic growth rate 3.6%. Next is second 5-year plan. In the second 5-year plan, the government focus was on the industrial development on the country. So first, within the first 5-year plan, so we have attained the self-sufficiency in the food product. So after that, we have to give some of the importance to the industrial also. So the government has to decide to focus on the industrial sectors. Next, third 5-year plan. So this third 5-year plan also called as a Gandhi Yojana also. So the main target of this plan was to make the economy independent and to reach the self-propelled positions. Next, plan holiday. Plan holiday means, so after 3 5-year plans, there was no 5-year plan. So the main reasons behind the plan holiday was the Indo-Pakistan war and failure of third plan. So because of these two reasons, the plan taken as a holiday. Next, fourth 5-year plan. The two main objectives was taken in this fourth 5-year plan. First one is the growth with the stability and the progressive achievement of the self-reliance. So already within the first 5-year plan itself, we got the self-sufficiency and the self-reliance. But even though we have to growth with the stability and we have to progress from the self-reliance. Next, the 5th 5-year plan. The target of 5th 5-year plan is achieved the growth rate from the 4.8% to 4.4%. Next, 6th 5-year plan. 6th 5-year plan. So the basic objectives of this plan was poverty eradication and technological self-reliance. So in this time, in this period 1982-85 only in our India, some of the poverty eradication program was implemented. So on the basis of 6th 5-year plan. Next, 7th 5-year plan. So the objectives of the 7th 5-year plan is included the establishment of self-sufficient, the opportunities for productive employment. So in this time only, the bank also has been increased and it was provided many financial facilities for the small-scale industries and the agricultural industries also. Next, 8th 5-year plan. So in this plan, the top priority was given to the development of the human resources. So the government was decided to increasing the infrastructure facilities and the educational facilities and extending the number of colleges and the other facilities also. Next, 9th 5-year plan. So the main objectives of this 9th 5-year plan was the growth with justice and equity. Growth with the justice and equity. So all the people have to get the good justice with the equal level. Next, 10th 5-year plan. So this plan aimed to double the per capita income of India in the next 10 years. So whatever we have to do for the next 10 years. So all these things was taken on this 10th 5-year plan. And not only that, it aimed to reduce the poverty ratio to 15%. Because the poverty reduced on that time means 10%, but it was reduced to with the 10%. Next, 11th 5-year plan. The main objectives of the 11th 5-year plan is faster and more inclusive growth. Faster and more inclusive growth. Next, 12th 5-year plan. So the last 5-year plan and the objectives of this last 5-year plan is faster and the sustainable growth. Because if you are growing as faster, we must focus to growth with the sustainable. So this is the important factor. So the 12th 5-year plan gave the most important to the faster growth with the sustainable. Okay, students, so till this 5-year plan, our 8th lesson has completed. So we have some time, so we will go to the next lesson. Okay, students, so next chapter is chapter 9, the development experience in India. Wherever the India got the experience, development experience in these days. The year 1991 is an important landmark in the economic history of post-independent India. The country went through a severe economic crisis in the form of serious balance of payment problem. So Indian economy responded to the crisis by introducing a set of policies known as structural reforms. So the Indian government has taken and created many structural reforms. So among these reforms, the one of the most important reform is the liberalization, privatization and the globalization. As a new economic policy is 1991, so the LPG was introduced. The meaning of LPG or the expansion of LPG is liberalization, privatization and globalization. So first we must about the meaning of the expansion of LPG, the liberalization, privatization and globalization. Next, the meaning of liberalizations. What is the meaning? So liberalizations refers to the removal of relaxation of governmental restrictions in all stages in industries. So before the 1991, so the government has more restrictions to the industrial field, because many of the private sector will never come to the industries, most of the industries. But after the 1991, so by the way of de-licensing, de-control, de-regulations, subsidies and greater role for financial institutions are the various facts of liberalizations. So if the governments are liberal, the privatization, liberal their policies to the entrance of the private sector is considered as a liberalization. Next, privatization. So privatization means transfer of ownership and management of enterprises from the public sector to private sector. So it is the transferring the ownership from the public sector to private sector. So even in our nations are said to be increasing or growing, some of the sectors are not maintained as efficiently. So the decided of our nations, some of the important sectors are transferring to the private. So the disinvestment, denationalizations and opening exclusive public sector enterprises to private sector are the gateway to the privatizations. So after that privatization, so many of the private industries or the private sectors or the private peoples are taken up the government sectors, that is the important sectors. Next, the globalizations. So globalization refers to the integration of the domestic economy with the rest of the world. So the, all the nations can have the power and the possibilities to make the investment, to start any industries and export their goods to all other rest of the world. So the tariff, non-tariff barriers, opening the doors to the foreign direct investment and the foreign portfolio investment are some of the messages toward the globalization. Next, arguments in favor of LPG. So some of the economists and some of the industrialists also has given some of the arguments in favor of LPGs. What are the arguments in favor of LPGs are? The liberalization was necessitated because various licensing policies were said to be deterring the growth of the economy. So before the 1991, so the government has many restrictions to providing the licensing. And because of that, the industrial sector did not improve as to improving our economy. Next, privatization was necessitated because of belief that the private sector was not given enough opportunity to earn more money. The government sector people, the government sector did not give more employment opportunity and more did not give any opportunity to earning the more money to the public. But after given to the private sectors created many employment opportunities and give more opportunities to earning more money. Because of that, the gross domestic product of our nations was also increased. Next, the globalization was necessitated because today a developed country can grow without the help of the underdeveloped countries. So just if you are thinking yourself, you could understand, because many of the raw materials are going to the developed nations from the developing or underdeveloped countries. Because many of the underdeveloped countries only are producing or involving in this agricultural sector, and many of the industries, many of the raw materials for the industrial sectors are coming from the agricultural sectors only. So the natural and human resources of the developing countries are exploited by the developed countries and the developing economies are used as a market for the finished goods of the developed countries. So after the privatization, so many of the peoples are come to our host countries in the name of foreign direct investment, and all the human resources, all the natural resources are used only for our increasing in gross domestic product. Next, arguments against LPGs. So even many of the economists and industrialists are given up some of the favorable arguments. Some of the economists and industrialists and some of the common people also given up some of the argument against the LPGs. So what are the arguments of against the LPGs? The liberalization measures, when effectively enforced, the favor on unrestricted entry of the foreign companies in the domestic economy. Such an entry prevents the growth of the local manufacturers. So if you are allowing the LPGs, many of the entrepreneurs or many of the investors from the developed countries are come to our nations, and they will start that any of the industries, and if they will produce any of the product by using our natural resources, and not only that, it will be affecting our manufacturer of host countries. Next, the privatization measures the favor of continuance of the monopoly power. So only the powerful people can sustain in a business market. The social justice cannot be easily established and maintained. So if you are allowing the privatizations, so the big rather rich people will start at any of the industries, and in the beginning he will sell their product as a local at the low price, and after that, so after exhausting our local manufacturer, so the foreign manufacturer will become as a monopolistic power. Next, as globalization measures tend to integrate all economies of the world and bringing them all under one umbrella, so they pave the way for redistribution of economic power at all that world level. Only the already well-developed countries are favored in this process, and the welfare of the less developed countries will be neglected. So if you are allowing the LPGs, some of the well-developed nations only can easily dominate all other developing or developed countries, and these peoples can easily dominate the world politics. So for this purposes, some of the economists argued against the LPG. Here we have to note one thing: some of the major changes was arranged after 1991. So the foreign exchange reserves started rising, and there was a rapid industrialization, and the pattern of consumption started improving. So even many of the problems are there, some of the benefit also extended from one nation to another one of the nations because of our LPG policies. Next, industrial sector reforms. The Prime Minister of India announced the new industrial policy on July 24, 1991. This policy only is considered as a new economic policies. So it was radically liberalized the industrial policy itself and deregulated the industrial sector substantially. So some of the important initiatives by the government towards industrial policies. So the industrial de-licensing, de-reservations of the industrial sector and the public sector policy, abolition of MRTP Act and foreign interest policies. So on the next class we can elaborately explain about these five industrial policies. Okay student, if you have any doubt in these liberalizations or the new economic policies or the 5-year plan, just you ask me, and if you have any doubt, just we can talk within the interactive sessions. Thank you.